An unknown poet once wrote, "I shall walk this way but once. Therefore, whatever good I might do, let me do it now. For I shall never walk this way again." In these words exists the credo of one Olympic athlete who competed in Athens and dreamed of more than gold.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the finalist.
It is 8:15 p.m., Wednesday, August 18th, the Olympic Aquatic Center. 20-year-old Otilia Jędrzejczyk of Poland prepares for the 200-meter butterfly, the third of three events for her in Athens. She has already won two silver medals 3 days before. Otilia is the first swimmer in 28 years to win two individual medals in one day. On this night, there is additional drama. Otilia has come to Athens to accomplish what no swimmer from Poland has ever done before, to win an Olympic gold medal. But there is another goal that motivates her even more than her love for her country. It is a dream that lies deep in her heart. A dream that began several months before the Olympics while she was at a swim meet. There, between races, she read a book about a 10-year-old boy dying of leukemia, as told through his letters to God. Otilia, a deeply religious person, was affected by the boy's story.
That book is about the 10-year-old boy who had the leukemia. And I read this book before the competition, about 2 hours before my start. I read, and I said, no, if I finish, I go. The 200 meters, you know? But I have to finish. I have to finish this book. And when I finish, I'd be so cry.
Before leaving for Athens, Otilia makes a promise to herself and to God. If she wins a gold medal, it will be for the children suffering from leukemia in her beloved country of Poland. Now here in Athens, the eight finalists in the women's 200-meter butterfly get ready for the start. Although Otilia is the world record holder and world champion in this event, she is not the favorite. Patria Thomas of Australia is considered to be Otilia's chief rival. Thomas defeated her 3 days earlier for the gold medal in the 100-meter butterfly. The competitors will swim four lengths of the pool. Otilia, third from the top, falls behind Thomas in the early part of the race, but this is part of her strategy.
Patria Thomas is a sprinter, and I knew she would set a fast pace for the first 100 meters. I told Otilia not to go with her, but to hold back and save her energy for the last 50 meters. Hopefully, she would have enough energy to outlast Thomas.
At 100 meters, Thomas leads. She is on pace to break Otilia's world record. With just 50 meters to go, Otilia has erased Thomas's lead. They make the turn together.
I know I have to swim the last 50 meters really fast, because Petra, she usually swims this fast. I said, okay, it's last 50 meters, swim and swim, because I didn't see her.
Otilia wins by 31 hundredths of a second. Patria Thomas second, Yuko Nakanishi of Japan third.
And when I finished this race, I said, yeah, yes, I win. It's my Olympic gold medal.
Later that evening, the award ceremony takes place. Otilia receives the gold medal. For the first time in Olympic swimming history, the national anthem of Poland is played.
I was so very happy. I'm like, oh God, I never see so much people from Poland. They are so very happy. They are with me now. And when I stand and the people, they are singing, I know it's the best moment in my life.
Just before the award ceremony, She told me she was going to have to enjoy the gold medal very quickly because she was going to give her medal away. At first I thought she was crazy. Then she told me about her promise to God, that if she won a gold medal, she would sell it and give all the money to a children's hospital in Poland. I don't know if I was prouder to see her up on the award podium or prouder knowing what she was going to do with her medal when she got home.
Upon her return home to the small coal mining town of Rudoslovska, she receives a hero's welcome. The whole country celebrates Otilia's first swimming gold medal for Poland. For Otilia, this celebration is just part of her Olympic dream. After her return, Otilia makes public the secret she has shared with only her coach, family, and closest friends. She announces she will sell her gold medal in a public auction and donate the proceeds to the children's hospital in the nearby city of Wrocław. When the auction is complete, a Polish food company purchases the medal for over $80,000.
I've been in the hospital when I give this money to Wrocław. The children's, it's perfect, I think. When I go to my car with my coach, I go and I cry. I said, oh God, this moment I said, it's my life is very good. I know it's very good. Children is future and we have to help these children to be better the next year.
And so the gold medal that shone so brightly on the evening of August 18th in Athens now shines brightly on the faces of the children it has helped throughout Poland. Said Otilia, I do not need to see the gold medal to know that I won it, for it will always reside in my heart. Her heart, that all in Poland refer to as Otilia's heart of gold. It is 8:55 p.m., August 24th, the Athens Olympic Stadium. 15 women are entered in the final of the pole vault. First contested 4 years ago in Sydney, it is an event that will span well over 3 hours. And before the victor is crowned, the 80,000 spectators will witness the finals of 5 other events. With 200 meters to go in the men's 3,000 meter steeplechase, 3 runners from Kenya are leading. Since 1968, Kenyan athletes have won the gold medal in every steeplechase they have entered. Ezekiel Kemboi wins. His countrymen take the silver and bronze. For the 8th time in Olympic history, a Kenyan has won the gold medal in the steeplechase. The track is now set for the final of the women's 100-meter hurdles. The favorites, Joanna Hayes of the United States in lane 4, and to the left in lane 5, Perdita Felicien of Canada, the world champion. Felicien falls at the first hurdle and takes Irina Sevchenko of Russia out of the competition as well. Joanna Hayes wins the gold medal, setting a new Olympic record. Though American men have won this event 18 times, it is only the 3rd time an American woman has been victorious. In the women's 400 meters, the favorites are Tonique Williams-Darling of the Bahamas in lane 4 and Ana Guevara of Mexico in lane 3. Guevara is the world champion, but Williams-Darling has defeated her twice this year. Coming down the final stretch, Guevara, number 2517, and Williams-Darling, number 1131, are even. It is an historic victory, the first individual Olympic gold medal won by an athlete from the Bahamas. On the infield, there are 5 competitors left in the women's pole vault. Tori Elisidotis of Iceland, Anna Rogowska and Monika Pirak of Poland. And two Russians, Svetlana Feofanova, the world champion, and Yelena Isinbayeva, the world record holder. The bar is raised to 4.65 meters as the 10th and final event in the men's decathlon comes to its conclusion. 29-year-old Roman Chevrolet of the Czech Republic, number 1513, a world record holder and 2000 Olympic silver medalist, crosses the finish line to win the gold medal. And with it, the title of the world's greatest all-around athlete. As the Bahamian anthem plays for 400-meter champion Tonique Williams-Darling, the 80,000 spectators and millions watching on television await the most anticipated event on tonight's program, the men's 1,500 meters, featuring the premier runner over the past 8 years, Hisham El Garouche of Morocco. At the 1996 Atlanta Olympics, 21-year-old El Garouche was considered the new phenom of the 1500. But though expected to medal, he was untested on the Olympic stage.
In Atlanta, I was lacking experience. Before the final, I had an incredible amount of stress. And I was scared because it was my first time at the Olympics. There were so many spectators, the stadium was full, and I was not prepared for this pressure. So when the race started, I was already in a different world.
The favorite here in Atlanta is the current world record holder and three-time world champion, Nourdine Morsli of Algeria, leading in the green and white uniform. With one lap to go, El Garouche, number 1904, and Morsli make contact.
It was like a nightmare, a nightmare. In a fraction of a second, I was on the ground.
Morsli goes on to win. El Garouche finishes 12th and last. The following year, El Garouche becomes one of the best 1,500-meter runners in the world, defeating Morsli to win the world championships. Then in 1998 in Rome, Hisham breaks Morsley's three-year-old world record by more than 1.5 seconds. After winning his second world championship in 1999, El Garouche is the overwhelming favorite at the 2000 Sydney Olympics, with 28 straight victories in the 1500 meters. His principal competition is expected to come from two Kenyans, Bernard Lagat, number 2384, and Noah Nenny, number 2389, a world record holder in the 1000 meters.
Right before the race, 3 hours before, I started crying like a child. It had never happened to me before. I had thoughts that I might lose, and once I entered the stadium, I was scared. I did not have the confidence. First lap, second lap, third lap, I did not have the energy and the sensation that I usually have. And there he goes. Nenny goes by me. It's the rule of sport, always. When I crossed the line, I was sitting down and athletes were consoling me. I was looking at the Moroccan fans in the stands. Everyone was pale. Again, it's the rule of sport. You cannot have it all.
El Garouche will have to wait 4 years for his next Olympic opportunity. Meanwhile, he continues to dominate his competition. Undefeated over 3 years, he captures two more world championships in 2001 and 2003, and is ranked number one in the world for a seventh straight time.
It was my best year, especially due to the fact that I got married. My wife and I had decided to live a strict life, to be more disciplined. She wanted me to excel at the Athens Games. And just before the Games, we had a little girl, Iba. And I became much more mature, much calmer. But every time I trained, I tried to be as competitive and demanding as possible, to be ready to do baton.
Every Olympics has, I think, a central figure in track and field, whether it be Carl Lewis in 1984, Flo Jo in 1988. It was Elle Gourouge in 2004 because there was so much at stake. He was going to leave those Olympics with the title as the greatest middle distance runner ever, or the best never to win an Olympic gold medal. All the things he'd done in the past, those four world championships, those world records, counted for nothing had he not won in Athens.
Prior to the 2004 season, Isham's record is 80 wins and 3 losses. Two of those losses occurred at the Atlanta and Sydney Olympics. But 3 months before the Athens Games, Isham is plagued by allergies and respiratory infections. Losing 2 more races, he seriously doubts his ability to win. Because of this, Elle Gourouge is not expected to do well here in Athens. The favorite is Bernard Lagat of Kenya, number 2348, who defeated Elle Gourouge in their last pre-Olympic meeting and finished 3rd in Sydney.
The feeling was that he'd finished 2nd. That Lagat had his measure, and there was an irony in that because no one could have been a heavier favourite than Elle Gourouge in Sydney in 2000. I mean, he was unbeatable, and yet he lost. So that this meant so much more to him, and the consensus was that that favouritism that he'd enjoyed or endured had come to an end in Athens.
I lost in 2 Olympics, and I did not want to lose the 3rd one. Especially at the Athens Games, which were more important to me. It is the birthplace of the Olympics, and there is so much history here. In my mind, Athens is the supreme arena.
Down the stretch at the end of the 2nd lap, number 1576, Reyes Estevez of Spain leads. On his inside, Bernard Lagat, number 2348. Elle Gourouge moves along the outside.
I decided to accelerate and take the lead. It was the best time for me to do so. In the last 700 meters, I started to talk to myself, telling my body to perform well, to stay passionate and to ultimately win the race. Because it was such an important race for me, a race for history, I did not want to leave it as a loser.
He had one chance to win, and that was to take up the front and then to wind it up, and wind it up, and then wind it up. Now, he had the courage to put himself in that position. A lot of athletes in his position and what had happened to him at the other 2 Olympics would have given themselves an out. They would have put themselves in the 2nd best position to win so that at the end of the race there was an excuse. Not Elle Gourouge. He had the courage to put himself in the one position where there would be no excuses. And so he took up the front and it got faster and it got faster and faster. And he tried to take the sting out of Lagat.
Lagat and I were shoulder to shoulder. He then passed me. Then I passed him. That was the magical part. Once we crossed the finish, big relief. I was back to reality, and I started to realize that I was an Olympic champion in Athens. I thanked God and started thinking, and thinking of all the sacrifices and hard work for the past 10 years. And my emotions were overwhelming, and I started crying.
El Guerrouge finds his wife and daughter in the stands.
I held Iba in my arms. She was just 2 months old. I wanted to dedicate this race to her. One day, God willing, when she is older, she will always remember what her dad accomplished. I wanted her to bring me luck during this race, and she did.
With his Olympic dream finally realized, El Guerrouge celebrates. In less than 24 hours, he must compete in the heats of the 5,000 meters. But there is still one event to complete, the final stage of the women's pole vault. Three athletes remain. Anna Rogowska of Poland failed on her final attempt at 4.75 meters. She waits to see if her medal will be silver or bronze. With her countrywoman, Svetlana Feofanova, having already cleared 4.75 meters, Yelena Isinbayeva decides to move the bar up to 4.8 meters. The world record holder failed in her last two attempts. Another miss will eliminate her from the gold medal and put her into third place. Isinbayeva takes the lead. The battle for the gold is now between the two Russians. Feofanova cannot clear anything higher than 4.75 meters. Yelena Isinbayeva clears 4.85 meters. Though the gold medal is hers, she has the bar raised to 4.91 meters, 16 feet, 1 1/4 inches, a half inch higher than her current world record. With the evening of the 24th passing into the morning of the 25th, Isinbayeva makes her attempt. Isinbayeva breaks her world record. Four days after his victory in the 1500, El Guerrouge qualifies for the 5,000 meter final. It is the first time he has run this race at the Olympics. His competition will come from Eliud Kipchoge of Kenya, the world champion, and Ethiopian Kenenisa Bekele, the world record holder and 10,000 meter gold medalist 8 days earlier. There is additional significance. If El Guerrouge wins, he will equal the feat of Paavo Nurmi, the legendary Finnish runner. 80 years earlier at the 1924 Paris Olympics, he became the first and only man in Olympic history to win both the 1500 and 5,000 meters at the same games. With 8 laps to go, Abraham Chebe and Eliud Kipchoge of Kenya take the lead. Behind them, Bekele in the green jersey. El Guerrouge is seventh. With 250 meters to go, El Guerrouge is third behind Bekele and Kipchoge. El Guerrouge overtakes Kipchoge. The race is now between the two Olympic champions, Kenenisa Bekele of Ethiopia and Hisham El Guerrouge of Morocco. Later that night, he is awarded his second Olympic gold medal.
It was a fantastic moment.
I waited 8 years to be on the Olympic podium, which for an athlete is a dream come true. It was very special since I lost twice, and everyone was waiting to see what would happen in my third Olympics. And I won. But I worked very hard for it. I had tears of joy, happiness, and sadness all at the same time. Everything was mixed up. It was very moving. Those were moments that will stay with me forever and will never be duplicated. It was fabulous.
Hicham El Guerrouj has spent years in pursuit of one gold medal. Now, in a span of 4 days here in Athens, he has two.